Why I say I can talk is because I see a lot of good things are happening, and I can stay home more often.
Are we on there now?
He's, right? He's got the picture over your head.
Okay.
When you're 83 years old, you need peace and quiet.
Live, once you call it.
Okay, I'll call the town council workshop December 19th to session at 7:03 PM. Councilors Glennon and Quox are excused tonight. Councilor Glennon had a extra postal duties due to the holiday. And the first item on the agenda is Resolution 2007-45, the Municipal Audit Committee. And this resolution was prepared after feedback from the last council meeting. And we're affording an opportunity for anybody from the public to provide input to the council on this. I'll just highlight the committee function to make sure we're all on the same page for this one. This is the Municipal Audit Committee, Resolution 2007-45. And just wanted to thank Councilor Jarvis will be a few minutes late, but she will be here. And the changes that were made were to make the membership consist of two members of the council and three members of the public, which was the reverse in the original proposal. There were some minor corrections otherwise. Other than that, there were no substantial changes to this one that I recall. So at this point, I'd open it up for anybody from the public that would like to comment on this resolution, which is for the Municipal Audit Committee, and this is the committee that's a permanent standing committee of the town with the responsibility of participating and overseeing the annual audit of the town's finances and internal controls. So would anyone like to speak on this?
This committee?
This is number Resolution 45, the Municipal Audit Committee. If you would like the opportunity, please come up to the mic. Just state your name, of course, for the record.
Yeah, Ed Puterata, longtime resident of Newmarket, many, many, many years. What I want to comment on, I've read this from the last meeting you guys had, all of it.
Great.
And I think that finally something's going in the right direction. And it makes me feel good because things have happened. We found them. You have agreed with you in the audit. And I was surprised so many things were found in this audit. But as far as this committee's concerned here, it's a good idea. Going in the right direction, I approve of it. I won't even go to number two yet, but I approve all of it. I was going to say that night, but of course the meeting was over. But I'm glad that this is coming about. And we're finally working with the taxpayer, the public, and everything else together and ironing all these problems out and help. I hope we do have the right people that will be nominated for this. Because it's a good idea, because maybe we find there's some people out there that are good professionals that were in some company they work with that they had a lot of these things and they know how, what to do and everything else. And it'd be good to listen to them. And I hope that everything comes out good. I just want to thank the council that I guess you wrote up some of these agendas into on the papers we had last week, like the credit card thing and all that stuff.
Well, yeah, Mr. Parnell wrote the credit card policy.
But all these, I'm just going back to that thing there because I read it all there and I thought, I'm glad to see it. I feel good about it because, you know, I do go to a lot of meetings and everything else. Sometimes I get carried away maybe, but anyway, just that I'm interested in the town to progress as a good, honest town and everything else. But right now, a lot of people are saying different things from out of town, and but something like this should be published in the paper also to show that what we're doing to correct the situation. Advertise it and everything else.
I agree.
Anyway, I just thought I'd bring this up and tell you.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Parker. Anyone else like to comment on Resolution 2007-45, which is on the Municipal Audit Committee? Mr. Fitzgibbon.
We got a quorum?
Yes, we have a quorum. And we're expecting the fifth.
Yeah, okay, thank you. No, I'm just going to repeat what I said last week.
Okay.
As a matter of fact, I was a little bit premature myself, in a sense, because I thought last week's meeting was going to be similar to what you've had today with regard to public comment. The only thing I want to do is repeat what I said last week. In view of the fact, you know, we've had, probably to use a rather strong word, traumatic experience the town has. And everything was fine with the way it was handled with the petitioning and then the preliminary audit to make sure that we needed a forensic audit, and which everybody agreed with you people, and that's fine. The only thing that I have not a problem with, but would make me want to hesitate a little bit and with deference to being a little bit more prudent, is the fact that we have had the meeting with the public commentary a couple back in November. However, I'm not against committees. That might be a bold-faced lie, really, because they're not kicking the door down to get on committees here when I was sitting there. And anyway, my point is, it's, you know, input is good, so you get it through committees, that's fine. However, I just still think that it's really premature, and that doesn't mean I'm totally unequivocally against both these types of committees. They both have their purpose, and I can see where you've felt that they do have their purpose. However, I still think it's premature. I don't beat that word to death. But it would seem that whether or not you want to go ahead with this would be particularly contingent upon what happens with regard to an ongoing investigation by both the AG and the county. They may come up and say, hey, you know, you guys are getting a little bit too excited. There's been no criminality here. They may come up with something that says there's some criminality here, and I don't say that that is the one thing that's contingent on whether or not you need these committees. But it may have you take a different view of whether or not you even need this. You know, you are the legislative body of the town, according to the charter. You are the people that doesn't mean we have to agree with everything you do. Except for me, everybody agreed with what I did. But my point is, you know, I just think for that reason it is premature. I think you should have everything, all the evidence or information that you can have in before you do this, these two resolutions. That's as simple as that. Okay, thank you.
I need to step outside for a second. I'm sorry to interrupt, but I'll be back in a second. Sorry about that. Someone popped in. I thought I had to stop and say hello. Councilor Plasky? Sorry. Is there anyone else from the public that would like to speak to Resolution 2007-45? Sorry, we got a little feedback echo going on. Okay. So I'll close the public comment session at 7:10. And Councilor Plasky?
As far as Resolution 2007-45 goes, as it's written, I am against it. I think the oversight of management reporting controls of the town of New Market's finances is nothing more than micromanaging. We went through, as Mr. Fitzgibbons put it, a very traumatic experience, this town. When the townspeople elected each and every one of us, they put their faith in us. As far as the mistakes that were made that were found in the forensic audit, the only thing any member of this council is guilty of is trust, trusting in the employees that we hired. And I think that to oversee management is, again, just micromanaging and is not fair to our employees, to our town manager, to our finance director, who are making every effort to do the finest job necessary. The part of the Municipal Audit Committee that I do support is the fact an oversight of the audit after the auditor is done with it. Because most of us that are elected don't necessarily have an accounting background. And with people on this committee that do have an accounting background, it will give the council a fairer shake at understanding and looking at the audit itself. My one question on selection of the members, of the three general public members, will we be verifying their accounting backgrounds? That's everything I have for right now.
Councilor Branch?
I guess I understand what Councilor Plasky is saying. Probably the biggest concern or issue that I have with this whole process is the fact that over the years we've had safety nets in place. We've had finance directors, town administrators, auditing firms that have come in and done the job. And there's three safety nets there that failed. They failed the system. And at this point, you know, to move forward, which is the goal of, I believe, everybody that sits up here, is to move forward. At this point, my biggest question is, what harm does this do? It instills, I mean, I listened to Mr. Porterata speak earlier, and no offense, Ed, but, you know, you don't always hear him come across as a positive speaker when he's talking to the council. And he had good things to say. We're taking, for lack of a better term, we're taking the bull by the horns, getting things established. This committee is, I assume, or I believe, is going to be a ongoing committee. The second one we're going to vote on later on is more of a temporary one. As long as we need it, we keep it. That's not to say this one will go on forever and ever, you know, and hopefully it doesn't have to. I mean, I'd be the happiest person in the world if we don't have to have people checking. But at this point, we do, and that's why I'm in favor of this resolution.
Okay. Thank you, Councilor LaBranch. Is anyone else that from the council that hasn't spoken yet that would like to speak? Councilor Hamlin?
I guess I'm going to say nothing more than to repeat what Mike has said, Councilor LaBranch. We've been accused of not paying attention to our duties in the past when all the time Simons, he mentioned the last meeting, I think, where none of us had the qualifications for auditing, or I certainly didn't sign on to be an auditor or to watch people that work with figures. I never would have signed on if it was for that, but I don't see where this would. I don't feel that it's a counselor's duty to stick his nose into the finances. I mean, not to ignore them, but to watchdog the move of every people upstairs, all the people upstairs in charge of our finances. But micromanaging at times, it could be called micromanaging. And we've got enough to do without being people that aren't educated in that field. I'll speak for myself. Some of you have been. I don't think this would do any harm at all to have someone, not someone to take the blame for things, but to keep an eye open. Without repeating myself, I'm in favor of this committee. Thank you.
Councilor Jarvis, did you want to speak before I let Councilor Plasky go again?
No, that's fine.
Okay, Councilor Plasky.
Again, the part of this that I don't support is the internal controls. I think an audit committee to oversee the audit itself, the annual audit that we have, is a very good idea and will be a very helpful tool to the council, to any council that sits up here. But to sit back and watch over everybody. We just hired a new town administrator. We recently had a town finance director hired. And it's a discredit to both of these people and to this council that hired them to sit there and watch over their backs, They're both, right now, working on these problems that we found in this forensic audit. And we're going to have some very unhappy employees in this town if we go through with this and they feel they're being looked over terribly. They don't have to be. We have good employees in this town. We were very thorough in picking Ed as our town manager. And I think it is just a major discredit to him not to let him and his department heads work on the problems we have. And leaving the internal controls part of this resolution is just a travesty.
I have to strongly disagree with the characterization that you're putting into this. And the internal controls is the biggest failure that occurred underneath the previous administration. And it's because we weren't doing the oversight of it. And I trust Mr. Winowski and I trust Mr. Parnell, but you know, the best experience I learned from what just happened is that we need to have something like this so we can occasionally double check. I don't think portraying it as micromanaging is accurate. And I think that anybody within the municipal community would recognize this. This is something that should have been occurring whether we had it as an audit committee or not. And I also think that the way it's been framed provides sufficient guidance, so there's not going to be overzealousness on it. And also, you know, makes it clear that we're expecting that Ed and Don will see the policy and make sure it's followed. And when it's not, send the bill back and say, hey, this hasn't been signed off on. Or that's not an appropriate expenditure. And I know someone's going to see that it's not because they're going to be checking. And this might be one of the bills that gets pulled out. Now, we all know the regular auditor is supposed to do this. But this will also help supplement that. So that's the only comment I'll provide on this. And obviously, I support it. Councillor Wolford Hamill, then Councillor Jarvis, then Mr. Winowski.
Ed, what's your feeling on, would you feel that you and Don Parnell are being, you know, looked over your shoulders, and how do you think the employees upstairs will take this?
Well, I guess I'm not waving the flag on the committee, but I don't see it as an unnecessary or an intrusion into the responsibilities that this council has entrusted on both myself and Don Parnell. At this point, you know, the town has been through a traumatic experience. People that you had in place where you felt were carrying out the responsibilities on a day-to-day basis probably let you down. And I think that at this point in time, the commitment from all the staff is that we're going to work together to correct this. I mean, I've just been in last week, just yesterday, was looking at the accounts payable and noticed that department heads are starting to put more information just to clarify the bills as they're coming through. So when you can look at them, you know where it is going through. You know, I said to the department heads today, and I think I said it last week, you know, my goal is that this committee gets worked out within 5 or 6 years, because we are doing the things that are necessary to carry it out. You know, the commitment that we have is, when I say we, it's Don Parnell and I, is that when the management letter comes out and says you need to address X, Y, and Z, we're committed to doing that. Working with the council and working with the committee to ensure that we get the policies in place. So that everybody is clear about it. The council members know what we have to do, the department heads know what we have to do, and everybody's on the same page. So, you know, am I totally 100% enthusiastic? No, but, you know, I see it at this point in time as something that, as we've talked about, the desire to bring the trust and integrity back into this community, in this town hall, and more importantly, to make things more transparent. So if somebody says, I'd like to see X, when they look at it, they'll have an understanding as to what's going on and feel comfortable that, you know, their tax dollars are being used frugally and for the purpose that they were set aside for.
You don't think there'd be any damage with relationships? With the relationships with the employees upstairs that are doing this every day?
No, I think that the one thing, the benefit of this is that questions that employees had in the past as to why they were doing certain things are being, you know, they're now feeling much more reassured that when they get an explanation as to how to move forward, if they have a question, that they're getting the right answer and that we're all doing it. You know, it's not unusual for two or three of us, Don Parnell, myself, and one of the other staff members to get together and have a conversation as to where we're going, and then following it up with an email or a letter to one another as to this is what we discussed, this is the procedure we're going. And that way, that's you know, everyone's feeling comfortable about that. So if something happens, we hold up that email and say, well, you agreed to this. And it's like, yeah, you're right. Okay, that's the way it is. So I think it's beginning to build even a stronger relationship among all of us at this point.
Thank you, Ed.
Thank you.
Council Jarvis.
Sorry for being late. Can I assume that there's a motion on the table to adopt resolution?
No, not yet.
Oh, okay. can I have one edit on the third page under internal controls B? Previously reported have been addressed, not addressed. But otherwise, I think it looks good the way it's been revised to add our revisions. Thank you.
Ed, did you have the opportunity to speak your mind when Ed Wilford asked you? Okay. Councilor Ranch?
Would you like a motion?
Sure.
I'll make a motion to adopt Resolution 2007-45, forming a municipal audit committee.
Second.
Okay, so Councilor Branch makes a motion. Councilor Wilford Hamill seconds it. Do we have any further discussion? Sorry, I'm laughing because we did a little out of order, but that's all right. All right, please call a roll.
Councilor Plasky?
Nay.
Councilor Hamill?
Aye.
Councilor LaBranch?
Aye.
Councilor Jarvis?
Aye.
Chairman Hart?
Aye. Motion carries 4-1. Okay, the next item on the agenda is Resolution 2007-46, the Fiscal Year 05-06 Forensic Audit Follow-Up Committee. And we'll have a public comment opportunity as well on this. And this resolution was revised after the last meeting by myself, and Mr. Ranowski reviewed it as well. Hopefully I can accurately represent the discussion of the council. I know one thing is a problem is that in the underneath dissolution, the date of May 2nd is before the date of May 30th in item C of number one. So probably needs to move to May 30th or we revise all the dates. That's the one area that I forgot. So underneath the solution, it says May 2nd is the ending date for the final report, but item 1C says May 30th is that the committee will issue the report after reviewing the transactions. So this resolution creates a temporary committee that will end sometime in May that we'll have to revise tonight. And the responsibilities of the committee are to review some specific documentation or documentation for specific transactions that were questioned for lack of sufficient supporting documentation in the period of time of this audit, and provide specific steps to do that. To review the town and the certified public accountants policies and bonding for any possible coverage. To review recommend any specific areas from previous years for an in-depth review and how such a review might be completed and the cost. To be available to hear any specific concerns from the public regarding the town's finances from previous years and propose steps to encourage and support the reporting of concerns by the public and to support the council on any other responsibilities that we may delegate in the future. Again, this committee would have 5 members with 2 members of the council, 3 members of the public. So, Councilor Branch, did you
motion?
Well, first we'll have the public input, then I'll call in.
Okay.
So, Mr. Porter, I'll open up the public hearing at 7:26 p.m.
Just a short comment.
Okay.
Now, these committees how do you say that?
Plasky.
Anyway, I don't believe they're going to be there 8 hours a day, 5 days a week, are they? Looking over the shoulders of the town?
No.
So it's just going to be now and then, right?
They could be, though.
Because you haven't set that formula. On this new one there, this second one, the committee responsibilities, are all those items going to be included from 1 to 7?
But on the last time you were discussing some of those.
The revised resolution is up front, and it has five items now.
Oh, five?
We dropped two. Well, we combined one and dropped one.
What?
We dropped number three, which was about the Attorney General's office.
Oh. In other words, they will hold meetings now and then, I bet, to the public?
That all their meetings will be public unless they're discussing a specific personnel issue.
Yeah.
But I don't expect this committee will have many non-publics, if at all. So they'll be posted just like the council meetings.
It seems strange to have so many committees, you know, I mean, two where one's going to do the thing and the second one's going to back them up, or what?
No, this one's responsibility is specifically about the forensic audit that we just did and looking into more detail on specific areas that it identified as problems. The first committee we created is about working on the audit that began this month for the fiscal year that ended last June. And then their job moving forward is to work with the annual auditor, and the company is Melanson and Heath, and to provide support and interpretation of that audit to the council.
Well, when they hold these public meetings, will the public be able to say, well, I get an idea how we can do this to help the town out? Will they listen to you?
Yep.
Some comments and this and
I
that?
I believe if I was on the committee, I would welcome public input. So okay. I imagine the committee would as well.
Okay. Like I say, I'll do the same thing on this one. I agree to it. And like I say, like Mike says, me, I'm positive. I've never been negative too much. But, hey, after all, I mean, you know, I take an interest in the town.
Yep.
And everything else. So that's why I say everything going well. That's all. I'll say it again.
Thank you. Thank you for coming. Would anyone else from the public like to speak about Resolution 2007-46? Russ? Mr. Simon? And then Mr. Fitzgibbon, I believe?
Nope. I didn't have this copy of 45. I did have one question.
Okay. Mr. Simon.
Thank you, Russ Simon. My compliments on redrafting and getting this in shape to the town council. And I'm obviously in favor of it. The only, as a citizen, some of the issues that cross my mind that may not cross other people's minds, and I think that's one of the reasons to reach out to people to find out what their concerns are, is if there is an investigation, as I understand, by the state AG's office, which would probably preclude the county from being involved, as I understand it. There are many issues that are not related to a criminal investigation. And if the town council is going to look and pursue those, that's great. I looked at that as possibly one of the things that this committee would be concern itself with in at least looking at those issues. And if I gave you a couple of hypotheticals, there have been issues about misreporting of time or pension or vacation that may or may not have some effect on pension funds. That's not a criminal activity. That's an issue that has to be dealt with the pension authorities or the funds that exist. If you talk about business expenses that may not turn out to be business expenses, they may be considered compensation to that individual, and as a result, that compensation needs to be reported to the taxing authorities, okay? So there may be some tax-related issues. I remember that at least in one case, there was failure to issue a 1099 for consultant work a few years ago. I don't know of other occurrences that, and that may be a taxing issue as well. And so if the council is going to be looking at all of those, okay, and that's why I think this committee, when we put in supporting state or other agency or administrative investigations, I think there's a need to actively manage that to the extent that you keep in touch and you know what's going on, or if issues come up like that, that there's a methodology, let's say, for this committee to say, here are some thoughts. If these come up, what is the town council going to do? Or here's our recommendation on how to proceed. So I'm fine with this as it is, but I'm bringing up some issues that we tried to get at when we talked about supporting, okay, whatever the requirements are of those investigations and being able to assist the town council, because in effect this committee is just that. It's a support and advisory committee to the town council. That's it.
Thank you. Would anyone else from this public like to speak? Last chance, Jack.
Well,
Well, come on up to the microphone, please.
I'm assuming that you can understand 46 with regard to the forensic follow-up. I would assume that the under 45, that committee would be a little more protracted in its position than the forensic, which
yes.
is.
That's correct.
Just trying to make it sound complicated. shouldn't there be a date here so that it would be there so that this committee, whether it's 1 year, 2 years, or just 1 year, it would be ready for the town report?
The time frame is that for dissolution by May 2nd is
okay,
how it's currently drafted.
I didn't probably, have this ordinance yet.
Okay, it'll probably be more like May 30th.
Thanks,
but.
Fine.
Okay, thank you. Glad we could clarify that. Councilor Ranch? Sure.
Like to make a motion to adopt resolution 2007-46, a fiscal year 05-06 forensic audit follow-up committee be established.
Second.
Okay, Councilor LaBranch makes the motion. Councilor Jarvis seconds it. And we have some lights on. Councilor Jarvis.
On page two, number five, I think that was says support the town council on other responsibilities as may be assigned by the town council. I think that's the piece, Mr. Simon, that we're looking at for some of those issues that you just brought up. Those are some things that we would say, okay, we've got a little bit more information on this, and then charge the committee with saying, okay, we want you to look at the 1099s that may not have been issued. Can you get that information back to us? So that I think that's that piece there that would allow that committee to still follow up on some of those things. And I thought it was May 2nd, not May 30th. So May 2nd for this C is what I thought it was. Your comment earlier, I think it is May 2nd instead of May 30th all the way around. It's the way I remember it, but I could be wrong.
They need to be consistent. I'd prefer that we got it while I was in the council. I'd like to.
I think that's what one of the comments was, is that if we got them by May 2nd, that it would be this council that started the committee that would be able to review it.
It would be May 7th, but it would be our last meeting. But yeah, at least we'd start. I mean, hope maybe some of the information will come before that. I'm sure it will. But. So are you suggesting that we change C to May 2 instead of May 30th?
Yes.
Is everybody comfortable with that? Can always. And then June 4th business meeting would be the May. I don't have the calendar for that far ahead.
I know.
One second, here we go. Okay, May 2nd is a Friday, then May 6th. Would be the June 4th would change to May 6th. Is that all, Councilor Jarvis?
That is, thank
all right.
You.
Mr. Winowski.
I guess I just wanted to echo what Councilor Jarvis said, is that I really think that the committee will have the opportunity to be looking at specific points that seem unresolvable to the department heads, which are presently looking at, you know, all of the paperwork that pertains to their department and getting the material to support that, the documentation that seems to be lacking. And there will be times where there will be some voids that will be created, and I think the committee will have the opportunity to dig into that. We do know that certain sort of bonuses and incentives that were given were done as account payable, and in contact and discussions with Melanson Heath, our current auditing firm, has given some direction to Mr. Parnell as to how we should approach that, and notification to the individual employees and to the IRS.
And I believe we have already done that.
We may have.
Yeah, we had already communicated.
It was just some discussion that we were having because we got some conflicting information.
Okay. Councilor Branch?
Just to kind of put these two committees into perspective, I think the first committee that we voted on is dealing with moving ahead, which is obviously our goal. This committee is more or less with dealing with issues that have come up in the past and see if there's anything that needs to be further investigated or discussed. The nice thing about both of these committees is, as far as people being concerned, that there's people out there running around doing things that they shouldn't be, there's at least two counselors on each one of these committees to oversee it, to report back to the chair, to ask questions if they think that they're overstepping their bounds or whatever is necessary. So I think it is important to realize that, you know, if we have the right people on those committees, which I'm sure we will, I think basically anybody up on this council is capable of being on these committees, with their reports back to the chair, back to the council, everybody will know what's going on, which is the goal of everything, as Administrator Winowski has said, to make it transparent, to let everybody see what's going on. So that's why I support this resolution.
Thank you. Is there any other, Councilor Plasky?
On item three, recommend any specific areas of the town's previous fiscal years. This committee, as it's written, is for the 05-06 audit. I think adding, recommend any specific areas of the 05-06 audit, which would indicate a need to review previous fiscal years for an in-depth review, how much a review might can be completed. But I think having them pick out specific areas of the 05-06 audit that would indicate maybe we do need to look at this particular item, such as payroll documents, which I know partially is already being done. That would be a change I would recommend on this. And the other one I'm a little bit uncomfortable with is number four. Be available to hear any specific concerns from the public regarding the town's finances during the previous fiscal years. Again, this committee is supposed to be looking at the 05-06 forensic audit. And now we're saying, let the public come in and say, okay, let's go into other years. I think this particular item would have better fit in the resolution that was just passed for the other committee, especially where this committee is only temporary and the other committee is more permanent. That's it.
Okay. The number three is, we can add if you want to clarify, but the intent is to make those recommendations of specific areas based on the audit that they're looking at.
I think that should be said in words.
Okay. Based on the fiscal year 05-06 audit report, recommend any specific areas. That's what I would suggest as a revision to address that concern.
That's acceptable.
Does that make sense to everybody? Is that okay?
Number
three would read, hopefully Erica's getting this too, based on the fiscal year 05-06 audit report or forensic audit report, recommend any specific areas, blah, 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 dot, dot, dot. I'm not so sure. I don't agree on number four, and we debated that pretty well last time, but Councilor Jarvis.
I mean, if we want to put that in there, that's fine. I think it's just a little bit redundant because this is what the resolution is for, the fiscal year 05-06 forensic audit. And number four, it sounds like you had a problem with being able to, because it said previous fiscal years. Is that the problem with number four?
It sounds to me, the way that's worded, it sounds to me like any member of the public could come up and say, I have a concern over the 03-04 fiscal year on such and such a department's bills, with no reference made to the 05-06 audit. Anything that this committee does should be tied specifically, and each item should be specific on the 05-06 forensic audit. And I think that one doesn't address that.
And I think the way that it was set up was that it would be for the 05-06 audit, but that if there were questions that said, you know what, in 05-06, we see that there were a lot of issues in the payroll department, then they would come to us and say, I suggest you look at the '03-'04 fiscal year because I think you might find some more payroll things. And then we as a town council decide whether or not we want to expend any more resources to do that. The way this is put here, though, says be available to hear any specific concerns from the public regarding the town's finances during the previous fiscal years. So it gives people the opportunity to come to that board and say, not could you look at the 2003-2004 fiscal year, but to say, I didn't, you know, I got paid a bonus check 4 years ago and it didn't go through the taxes or something like that. They could come to this committee and say something like that. Then that would be a red flag that the committee would ask us to investigate in that area. This committee never has any authority to go past 05-06 unless we direct them as the council. And unless there's evidence or questions, red flags, in order to go back. So you're bypassing this, Councilor Pulaski, I think you're nervous to say that this committee is going to have the right to look into previous year's financial records.
That's the way it's worded.
It doesn't say that anywhere in this resolution.
Number four is so vague.
It's about hearing concerns, Mr. Councilor Pulaski. It's not about investigating those concerns and reporting them back to the council in the final report. I understand the concern, but I don't think it's the intent of the people who suggested this item or of me as an authoring it that would be the conclusion of the drafting.
Okay.
Because if I could just say one more thing, because instead of saying and investigate those concerns, it says and propose steps to encourage and support the reporting of the concerns by the public. So it always comes back to us.
Okay.
Thank you.
Would anyone else have any comments from the council or further discussion on it? So at this point, we've made a couple of changes. I want to make sure we all understand them. On the second page, item C, we've changed May 30th to May 2nd, 2008. And we've changed June 4 to May 6th. And item number three, we've added this at the beginning of the section based on the fiscal year 05-06 forensic audit report, comma, recommend, and then it continues on. And that's the only changes I've heard so far.
The dissolution?
We're keeping it at May 2nd because we've changed the other one to May 2nd. Okay. That way it comes to this council and this council can hear it and won't be able to do much at that point. But any further? Okay. So we have a motion which is to adopt it as amended, I'm assuming at this point, since the amendments have been by consensus, the revisions. And please call the roll, Mr. Winowski.
Councilor Pulaski?
Aye.
Councilor Hamel?
Aye.
Councilor LaBranch?
Aye.
Councilor Jarvis?
Aye.
Chairman Hart?
Aye. Motion carries 5-0. Okay, next item on the agenda is the town clerk tax collector monthly report. And Becky's, this was a mistake on my part. So Becky provided us with a great written report, which we have. And by agreement with the council, she's going to participate in council meetings on a more infrequent basis and when there's something of significance to report. So her not being here tonight is not an oversight on her part. It's an oversight on my part in setting the agenda. I want her and everybody to know that. But the key thing I think people should know, in case you haven't checked your mail, is that our primary is January 8th. And that's not very far away, so she's doing a lot of work to prepare for that. In addition, tax bills are due December 17th. So if you haven't paid your tax bill, there's still time to get down there and pay a small interest penalty at this point. So the next item is number four, revised drainage proposal from Underwood. I would look to Mr. Winowski or George to help guide this discussion, or Julie. Julie.
Bueller.
Thank you. At a prior town council meeting, I believe the council voted to put the entire drainage study proposal out to bid in January, with the thought that we would give estimated numbers back and then possibly put it out to a warrant article in May. In September, at the request of Vice Chair Glennon, a number of people met regarding the concerns of one property owner, Mr. Jarrez, down in the area of the Bowl. Mr. Winowski was there, the previous town administrator was there, Underwood engineers, myself, and a few others. What came out of that meeting was a suggestion by Underwood engineers to do a revised, scaled-back drainage study that would focus just on the area of Exeter Street and the specific drainage problems there, and to also investigate and then I think provide a 90% design solution for some kind of spillway. And Underwood's proposed cost for that scaled back drainage study is, I believe, $39,000. So I imagine that a few things have to happen. I guess the council needs to perhaps have some discussion or some consideration of the scaled back proposal. And if you determine that you want to do that at this point, we have to decide, I suppose, whether you want to go with Underwood engineers or put that also out to bid or do nothing or stick with our original suggestion of putting the whole drainage study out to bid in January.
Sure. Okay.
Yeah, or change that decision.
Administrator Winowski.
Julie's done a good job of sort of summarizing what's transpired, and I would ask that the council not move forward on this sort of partial study. We've done a tremendous amount of work down on Exeter Street and revamping the underground drainage, and I think that hopefully, if there's wood under here, that we don't have another 100-year flood in the spring. And to see how well the drainage system is working, and more importantly, let's look at the entire process that's contributed to some of the problems that occurred down in the Bowl area. And to just fix a piece at the very end when we have problems up above that need to be resolved, I think that we'd be spending money at the wrong time and in the wrong place. And so at this point, I'd ask that we just shelve this for the time being. In the course of next year, we start talking about how much a study is going to be, and probably in the next fiscal cycle in 09-10 to bring something forward to look at that and see how we want to proceed if we have to do something in that area.
Open it up for discussion. Thank you. Councilor Jarvis.
Is this the first that we're hearing about the scaled back proposal? Or did I miss something?
I'm having a hard time tracking this particular issue, given everything else we have. But
right.
I think we talked about the spillway, but I don't remember necessarily.
Here's my memory.
Please go ahead.
I remember really wanting to support the drainage study of the whole area down there, and that didn't get the support that I had hoped for. And then I thought that we were going to put it off and put that study off for the full area. This meeting that happened and this discussion about a scaled back proposal for just that one area, I wasn't aware of, nor do I think it makes any sense. When we talked about the drainage problems in that area, there were a number of contributors to why the water was coming to that area. So to isolate one area and think that we could solve a problem there, I think is a mistake. So I'm not sure how this even got started with the scaled back proposal, but I would suggest that the council doesn't entertain the idea. I think when we commit to looking at that drainage area, we need to look at the whole area. So I would agree with Administrator Winowski, and I guess I'm really surprised that this came to us tonight without any documentation of where the $39,000 came from or how it all. I'm missing that piece. I'm missing the piece of where it went from. Was it just a suggestion of working with the? I'm missing the piece of how we went from the getting a drainage study of the whole area to thinking that we might want to just do a drainage study of one area.
One of the property owners, Mr. Jarrez, who owns number 3 and number 11,
right,
Exeter Street, was concerned that some of the changes that we were making with the Main Street Reconstruction Project, we're going to possibly cause different flooding problems, specifically for his properties. Out of his concerns, we then had a meeting that I believe was instigated by Vice Chair Glennon. And as I said, Mr. Winowski was there. It may have been his second day in Newmarket. Mr. Dixon was there, Rick Malasky, Underwood Engineers, myself, I believe Diane Hardy. There may have been a few other people there as well. We stood in the area of Creighton and Prescott, talked about some of the drainage issues, listened to Mr. Jarrah's concerns. Out of that came the idea for the scaled back proposal. The $39,000, I thought you had a copy of Underwood's draft scaled back proposal as part of your packet.
It's not in the packet.
But that's where the $39,000 came from to answer that question.
Okay. So I guess I'm not the only one that's in the dark up here for how this went from one spot to the other. So I would agree that we don't discuss it tonight, and I don't think it's a very good idea. That's all.
Thank you for coming, Julie.
Nothing to do with you, Mrs.
Yeah,
Glover.
No, I know.
It's just
I know.
News to me, and I think that, I mean, as I said, that area, that drainage area is a huge area that needs to be talked about. So
The only point of clarification I guess I would ask is just we're still staying with what the original council vote had been a number of months ago, which was to put the entire proposal out to bid to obtain numbers, bring that back to the council with the possibility of putting it on a warrant article.
Yeah, what I understood is that we were going to ask to make sure the request for proposals said this price needs to hold through the voting date, and then the council decided whether or not to put it to a warrant.
Correct.
And as I wanted to emphasize, I'm against either study, as people are well aware, but you know, we'll see. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you for coming. Sorry for. Yes, Councilor LaBranche.
Can I back up just a little bit to the resolutions we just passed? We've put these resolutions in place. Who's going to be serving from the council? Has that been decided yet? Or
no,
who are the members going to be, I guess? Or how do we get the members?
Thank you for reminding me. So the public is welcome to apply, and I'm sure Administrator Winowski and Ms. Castle will start announcing that if they haven't already, because we had talked about preliminary announcement last week, and we'll have to decide if we do it at the business meeting or the workshop, given the holidays and the fast time that we're facing. In terms of the council, if anyone's interested, please call me or send me an email. Let me know which one you'd like to serve on, and if I don't get volunteers, I will appoint the people I think will do the best job. So it might be best to put your name in for one of the ones that you like, because you might find yourself on the other one. And I'm not, you know, I'm saying it in a threatening manner, but we'll need to have participation, and I think it should probably be four different people. So we have we don't burden certain folks with more than two more committees on top of everything else. The help?
Yes.
Okay. And I'll probably send a memo out this week just to remind people and specifically ask them. Thank you for reminding me. The next item is discussion of the Arbor Park, and the town planner is here, Diane Hardy, I believe, to help us on this.
Yes, certainly. Thank you, Councilor Hart. I have some conceptual sketches that I'd like to pass out. I don't have copies for everyone. I have three copies, so I'm going to ask if you could share, please. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Need a third arm. And, sir, you can move up over to the other side of the room. It's kind of hard to orient it, so we can all see. How's that?
Thank you very much. As you know, Councillor Dana Glennon was very instrumental in spearheading this effort and has been working on it long and hard for almost 18 months now, I believe. Just to give you a little bit of background, as you know, the town has received a $16,000 grant from COAST, which is our regional bus system, to make improvements to the Arbor Park, which serves as our downtown bus stop. And several groups in town, through the work of Councillor Glennon, have made contributions to this project and have provided support. And they include the Newmarket Gardeners and, of course, Timberland and our Main Street Corporation. The objectives of this project are to renovate the project to help improve the visibility of the park from the downtown, to open up views of the river, and to try to make the park a little more pedestrian friendly and inviting to the public. As part of this project, the Newmarket Main Street Corporation provided a grant to hire a designer by the name of Charles Hoyt Design to assist with the conceptual design of the park and also to work on a concept for an informational kiosk, which has been discussed over the months as being an integral part of our downtown improvement project. And tonight we have some renderings that Mr. Hoyt has prepared, including some sketches and a layout of what the renovations would entail. There's really two main elements to this project. My microphone's fading. Excuse me. Can you hear me okay? Okay. The first is renovations to the bus shelters. And in coming up with the design, Mr. Hoyt wanted to come up with a design that would be compatible and would fit into the architectural and historic character of our mill district. And in looking about the town, he came up with an idea of replicating the motif of the bell tower on top of the mill. And he incorporated that into his architectural design for the renovation of the bus shelter. And if you turn to page 3 of the materials that I've provided, you'll see where Mr. Hoyt got his inspiration, if you will, for the design. What he's proposing that we do. Sorry. And I'll point it out on the sketch. This is the bell tower on top of the mill. And he wants to redesign the bus shelters so that they have stairs. This is on the top row here is the elevations of the existing bus shelter. His idea is to provide cedar shingles and to enclose the bus shelter so it has a window and to include a fieldstone foundation and what he refers to as flared water tables at the base of each shelter. And the existing roof would remain, and there would be decorative frieze molding added to dress up the bell shelter. And thank you. Let's get it back up. I'll come back.
hearing.
One of the bus shelters will serve as an informational kiosk, which will have maps and an enclosed message board, and would provide information to visitors to the downtown and visitors to Newmarket about different businesses and activities and happenings in the town. The second aspect of it is site improvements, which would involve formalizing the entrance by extending the brick sidewalk that currently is there out to the street to tie in with the streetscape improvements that are going to be made as part of the Main Street project next summer. And the idea here is to open up the park so that it becomes a more integral part of the downtown streetscape. His plan also proposes the installation of 4 decorative planters, and he again was inspired. He's quite the world traveler, and he recently made a trip to Ireland. And in Ireland, there's a picture on page 2. In public, there's a larger version here. In Limerick Island, in the downtown streets, those downtown streets are lined with these decorative planters with flowering baskets, and they really add a lot of color and enhance the aesthetics of the streetscape. So, based on that idea, he came up with a similar design, which would include the placement of 4 planters along the front. And the flagpole that is there would remain, and there would be a sort of a planter that really makes it more of a focal point. And the planter would include some off-site lighting, spotlights for the flag. And the planter obviously could be planted with some annuals to provide, you know, color in the summer months. The plan also shows a stone wall. That would be constructed along the back portion, which would provide some definition to the planting areas. And there would also be some new benches installed and some decorative lighting that would be part of the overall plan. And I think I've covered everything. We have approximately $20,000 available at this time, and we're hoping that we can go out to bid and get some construction bids this winter so that we can start construction sometime next summer and again dovetail it with the Main Street work that is going to be occurring, and which proposes a concrete sidewalk right out in front of the Arbor Park area. So Julie Glover is here, and Julie, I didn't know if you had some comments that you'd like to share as well, and how this might tie in with the work that's going to be happening in the summer.
Thank you. The only comment I have to it that we are going to try on a certain number of the elements, particularly I think the brickwork that's anticipated, excuse me, we're going to try to have Severino's subcontractor that will be doing the other brickwork as part of the Main Street reconstruction project. So we probably won't be going out to bid for all of the elements of this plan, just because I think it makes more sense to just have the workers who are already in the area doing the work do this work as well.
Maybe we might both want to stay up there just in case there's any questions. Councilor Jarvis.
Did you say when you gave this presentation in the CIP committee, was there a mention that there's water that will go up into these light posts actually to water
I'm sorry.
Because a lot of times when we do projects and things like this, it adds to our maintenance costs of taking care of all of these new plants and things. So will you bring up that point too?
Supposedly these planters are self-irrigating so that there's a water system that's built into the planting ornamental planter, and it's on a timer system. And apparently they have them down at Quincy Market in Boston, and they work out fairly well. I think Mr. Winowski, you had seen them there and thought that might be a good idea for our downtown. A couple of other things I wanted to mention is This project is being done over many phases, and this fall, we had a contingent of volunteers from Timberland who came for their community service day called Surapalooza, and they provided a lot of labor to help get this project started, and they cut down some of the trees and pressure washed the arbor and cut some of the vines and so forth that had overgrown, and cleared out some of the brush that didn't really enhance the site, and it's really made quite an improvement. They also planted over 300 mums in the downtown. And just last week, we had a fencing contractor come in and put in a lovely fence around the perimeter of the park, sort of a black wrought iron style with granite detailing posts. And it really does enhance the Arbor Park and encloses the space and makes it much more inviting, I think. And so we're hoping, you know, slowly to work on all the different pieces, and hopefully by the end of the Main Street project, this project will be completed as well, and it certainly will be a complement to the downtown. Thank you.
When you say there's multiple phases, what are the other phases?
Well, we need to do the, we probably will do some landscaping, the benches, and, you know, work with Julie to try to integrate it in different pieces of it into the overall project. Mm-hmm.
But I mean, what you just outlined, I thought that was everything just outlined. Isn't that going to be done with
$20,000? Oh, yes, I'm sorry. This is what we're hoping to do in the first phase. Mr. Hoyt also provided us with an overall master plan, if you will, for the Arbor Park, which included some more grandiose ideas, including possibly having a sculpture garden and maybe having some kind of a design competition with the local residents to see if, you know, we could locate some art pieces within the Arbor Park. And he also had a longer range plan for just improving upon the landscaping. Mm-hmm. And, you know, if we'd have to do some fundraising and probably secure some grants to make those latter phases happen. But this first phase is really focusing on the entrance, if you will, so that we can tie the downtown and the Arbor Park together better.
Are there any other questions? Councilor Jarvis?
So just to follow up, so this design is really a phase one or two,
yes,
if you will.
This is really phase one, yes.
Phase one, okay. And this design, you have the funding, you feel like you can get this done within the funding you already have?
We have about $24,000. Timberland has provided us with an additional $3,000 grant, and the Newmarket Gardeners have provided some financial assistance. And we're hopeful, too, maybe that the folks from Timberland can come back in the spring and do some additional work to help us out with it, maybe some plantings or
so you so expect forth. This to be done at the end of maybe the spring?
It would have to be.
Or summer? Is that
I'm going to defer to our project coordinator on timing. I would think probably sometime midsummer that the actual work would be done.
Timberland does it twice a year.
Oh, I know that, yeah.
We actually don't have any engineer drawings at all for this, so really the first step is to somehow get at least enough of an engineered or architecturally designed drawing so that we can put components out to bid, or at the very least get, as I said, Severino to price some of the items. So I'm not sure exactly what the timing will be. I think the intent is certainly to have it wrapped up at the end of the fall along with the Main Street project.
Great, thank you.
Any other questions? Councilor Branch?
Yeah, for the design fees, is that coming out of the grant the money also?
No, so the grant fees so far, the design fees so far have been provided by the Main Street Corporation.
Okay, thank you.
Yes.
I think overall the design looks good, and this is being mostly managed by you. I mean, is there a committee? I'm trying to keep
sort
track of this
sort of an ad
one.
Hoc committee. Of course, Councilor Glennon has been, you know, coordinating the project and working with both myself and Julie Glover and Public Works Department, you know, it gets involved as needed.
I would like it if there was a presentation of the overall plan, because I don't want there to be misunderstanding about what the event end is, because I see this as the end, but then you're saying it other phases, and that's why I'm like, I need to know when the end's going to be. So it's not like every year there's another $10,000 needed, and it's like, well, mm-hmm. you know. So if Mr. Hoyt has other ideas, or that you and Councilor Glennon and other folks think are good, I'd like to have them all at once so we have a sense okay. of where it might go.
We can put together a little master plan, show how the different phases would fit together.
Okay. Councilor Plasky?
Something Julie said earlier about having Severino's subcontractors who are doing brickwork just do the work. I don't feel quite comfortable with that. I think by our charter, we have to put it out to bid. I mean, this is town property, and I think if we don't put it out to bid, we're leaving ourselves open for possible trouble. If Severino's subcontractor wants to bid on that and we accept that, that's different. But I think it has to go out to bid.
Ms. Glover?
We can certainly put it out to bid. Or again, and I'm just talking about the brickwork component, which is actually a relatively small part of the work, in discussing it with Mr. Glennon, I just proposed that because it seemed to make sense that while they were doing brickwork along Main Street, we would ask them to provide a price to do this work as well.
I agree, but just asking them for a price isn't necessarily putting it out for a bid, and I think by regulations we do need to put that out to bid, depending on what the cost would be on that, or estimated cost would be.
I also imagine we could do it as a change order to the original scope of work on the Main Street project.
That could be done.
That's what I had imagined.
Okay. Thank you.
Councilor Jarvis?
That was my suggestion, is that we just make it a change order, because we already did put this project out to bid, so to speak, in this downtown, and this is kind of a bump out of the sidewalk right where we have it, so I would see it as a change order.
All right, so the next step in this would be for us to authorize, for you to draft the request for proposals, or and then we authorize that being released at a business meeting? Ms. Hardy?
The architect is also getting some cost estimates from local contractors, and you know, I think that, you know, we can do some cost comparisons and ask the Saravina to provide us with a cost estimate, and given the fact that they're there, I would think their cost would be very competitive and they'd be able to do it.
I mean, for the whole project versus just the brickwork.
Okay. Well, this would be, I assume that they would do a good portion of the project.
Who?
You mean Severino?
Yeah. I mean, the construction part of it. I'm overstepping. Please let me know, Julia.
I would imagine that we would have to find a carpenter to do the work on the renovations yep. to the existing right. gazebos, and there is no carpentry work in the Main Street project. That's why I said that the only aspect of it that I would see is doing a change order to the Main Street project would be the masonry work, because that is work that is already included in the Main Street project.
All right, so may I suggest that the two of you work with Mr. Winowski and bring back requests for proposals that we can look at, and it might have the brickwork as a specific component that is price identified separately from the rest, so we can add or subtract it. Mm-hmm. Something, you know, you guys know what that means more than I do, but an add-on or a subtractor. And then we can make sure we can get this out in January or February, okay. which would be enough time, it sounds like. Okay. Any other questions or input on the design, or Councilor Jarvis?
Just two things. These light posts with the planters would be a great idea for the downtown area as well. Is that something we've already thought about, or they're similar to the ones that are going in the downtown?
I have to do some investigating on where we can purchase those and who the manufacturer of them is, but we can certainly entertain putting them in other areas.
Okay. And then should there be it sounds like this park has kind of been adopted by Councilor Glennon and the two of you as far as putting stuff together there.
I think, though, actually, that the intent is that it's being rolled into the Riverwalk Committee. And I think that that was also discussed at prior council meetings.
Well, there was a discussion that the Riverwalk was going, that the third phase of the river, or the second phase of the Riverwalk, was coming up the street right to end at Main Street. And when I was discussing this project, I mean, because this was this used to be called the Lamprey River mm-hmm. Park. So then, if you're saying the thought is to eventually turn this over to the Riverwalk Committee?
I don't want to speak for Mr. Glennon, but I believe that was his intent.
Because I'm just feeling like we should probably have some public input. I mean, just like we have committees with other parks, the Conservation Commission deals with certain parks. We've got Linked Together dealing with the Pocket Park, that we should have some kind of, I guess, committee other than the three of you to work on the park. And not, I mean, they would have, the public would be involved in it. And there'd be more of a formal committee. So if it's recommended that the Riverwalk wants to take over this, then maybe we should hear that more specifically from the Riverwalk Committee. I don't know what everyone else's thoughts are, but we need to have some kind of, I mean, right now it sounds like there are three people that are making all the decisions for this park area. So that we might want to have, it should be turned over to one of the committees, either conservation or if the gardeners, like we've get, you know, the Pocket Park is Linked Together, is doing that. I think we should have some kind of formal committee.
Yeah, I mean, we specifically removed from the resolution about phase, whatever the number is for Riverwalk, the reference to the Arbor Park. Because we didn't see that as part of it and connecting. Mr. Urbanowski?
No, I'll pass.
Okay. All right, I thought you were going to rescue us from this conundrum here. All right, well, we'll have to, I agree with Councilor Jarvis that we need to have a better sense of this work so it doesn't, we're aware of it. It's in the minutes of the Riverwalk, but it's good ideas and stuff, but it's kind of a surprise that $20,000 is a lot of money, and we were aware of it before, and that there's been a lot of work to get the match, which is good. So, anybody have any questions about design or anything like that? I mean, I think what you shared here tonight looks good. Okay. Thank you both.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
The next gen item is number 6, discussion of town council goals for 2007 and 8. This was not in the packet, but it was distributed in your boxes. Does everybody have one available for them to look at? Yes, it is for 2008-2009, excuse me. Thank you. Councilor Jarvis pulled this together. Would you like to summarize it for us? And have the discussion on it?
As soon as I find it.
Okay. Does anybody need it?
Thanks. Basically, this is for our for the CIP. We put the town council policy goals and objectives to help along with the CIP for everyone to see what the town council is working towards and why we're suggesting the things we do in the CIP. What I've done is taken the one that we approved last year and made some changes based on some suggestions from the council. I'll go over the 6 bullet points, and then if you have any other questions about, don't think I need to read the whole thing, do you?
No,
and maybe we'll have maybe we should have it out there. But number one, to continue efforts of conserving current water sources and investigating alternative water supplies for the town. Number two, complete phase 2 of the downtown improvement project. Number 3 is the audit. And I'll list those points since that's something we've been discussing quite a bit. Initiate the appropriate legal action to secure town assets and recoup funding as possible. To continue to update, revise, and implement town policies and procedures. C, to continue to review supporting financial documentation for past expenses. 4 is the budget, so that we can propose a fiscally responsible and transparent municipal budget that eliminates unnecessary and unapproved expenses. B is the same also for our capital improvement plan. 5 is to determine what constitutes adequate fire and ambulance coverage and investigate options to ensure adequate coverage. 6 is to increase the communication and cooperation with the school district to minimize overlapping of significant budgetary requests to the taxpayers. So I'll take any suggestions on how to edit it if anybody has any.
Councilor Branch?
Just quickly, if I don't have last year's in front of me, but one of last year's goals and objective, wasn't it to secure some areas for fields and things of that nature for adult athletics, things of that nature? Was that on last year's goals and objective?
I think so.
Because unfortunately, it's something that we're working on, but we haven't accomplished at this point, and I'd hate to see it dropped from our goals and objectives at this point. I think it's a very critical piece.
I don't think I have it here either. We can certainly add it to this one, and if I find that I just deleted it and going down, that we can add it. Did you want to specifically say for adult?
Fields. Okay. I mean, at this point, I think all we've got to do is find a place where we can play some sports, be it adult, okay, children, whatever.
Thank you, Jen, for pulling it together. And I don't have any additional comments. I agree with Councilor Branch to add recreational fields, and I had emailed you my comments, so I'm glad to see that you're able to incorporate them. Are there any other input or additional items that people would like to see on there, or things that you don't think should be on here that are on here? Okay, that's fine. Give everybody time to think about it. I guess we should put this to the business meeting to adopt and do it then formally while everybody's here. It's not going to hurt either way. All right. I'm just going to write that down so I don't forget. Okay, the next agenda item is discussion on lead cleanup at the shooting range. And the town contracted with Comprehensive Environmental Incorporated a year and a half ago, and we received a report on the conclusions of their sampling of the soil surfaces out there. And it identifies several different recommendations on how to proceed and cost options. And this was done because we wanted to have a sense of the potential risk of lead contamination of the town's water supply at the gravel packed wells out over the aquifer. So with that introduction, I think George Laney will talk to us about the, we had the full report several months ago. I could not locate it, but fortunately George passed out specific pages from
the final report. Came out in September and it was distributed sometime mid-September, and I made some photocopies of the information that I think is useful for tonight. The cover sheet is a map of a schematic showing the different piles of materials that were taken out of the shooting area, and any of the materials that are over the TCLP, if that is over 5 milligrams per liter, it's considered a hazardous waste and has to be disposed of accordingly. And we have 3 piles that are at that limit. Then there is a 4th pile that I've highlighted in a pink color. That's below the MCL of 5, it's 3.65 milligrams per liter. And the engineer recommends that we take that off site also, because it is our aquifer and we're looking at recharging up there with that. And then if you go over to page 15, we have the landfills that can accept this material and a cost breakdown for each of the landfills. The cheapest is Worcester, Mass, and that one is $6,720. That's just for the disposal of the materials. It's a lined landfill, and you can see the Scarborough, Maine, and Bethlehem, New Hampshire are some other options, but they're quite a bit more expensive. And then on page 16, there's a breakdown of the whole project, which includes the management plan, laboratory testing, soil testing, hauling, and disposal. The The one that was recommended is option A, which is the final treatment and disposal in Worcester, Mass, at a cost of $26,640. This doesn't include the disposal of that pile number 3, which is under the MCL, but that would be an additional $3,000, which I think if we're doing it, we should take that off-site. I guess I'm just here to see if you want me to proceed further in getting some sort of a contract and find out where the funding's going to come from. The water department initially paid for this study, which was, I believe, $12,000. I don't think it was right for the water department to pay for it since it was a police shooting range, but we had the money. But I think there's time for a warrant article. It's my opinion, but I just wanted to know if I should proceed with moving forward with this. We've got 3 or 4 months before we can do anything now until springtime, but the piles are up there. They're covered up with plastic and just waiting disposal.
All right, I'm sure we have some questions and then try to address your request. So you say we have 3 or 4 months, meaning?
Well, we've got until spring.
All right, we can move it now if we have the money.
We can move forward now as far as getting a final contract and pricing. This pricing is estimates, and we'll have to, you know, tweak it a little bit.
Okay. Ms. Szymanowski, you and I had a brief discussion about another option. Did that pan out at all?
Well, in the course of the this report, it talks about the possibility of bringing the material to Waste Management over at Turnkey in Rochester. But in reading this, one of the things that the gentleman that I spoke with there talked about the issue of having to run some studies to see if it meets the category of hazardous, which this does, and it needs to be handled a different way. And I think at that point, it sort of excludes these 4 particular piles that George is talking about because they wouldn't be able to accept it there. And I sort of our options become limited because of the fact that it's over the state standards.
So basically, these are the options we have.
That's correct.
That's not an option anymore. Okay. Councilor LaBranche?
So if we take Ms. Delaney's recommendation of putting it out on a warrant, we could still proceed with getting all of our quotes and everything, getting things lined up, and just wait until we have the vote, correct?
That's correct.
And the total cost, I mean, we've got 2 figures that we've actually got to add together. We've got to add the $67.20 along with the $26,640, right?
Well, I believe that's in there already. If you see the $67.20 is broken down into $28.80, which is the lined landfill disposal, and the trucking cost of $2,400, which that is the $26,640.
So the $26,640 is the final figure.
But I would recommend going up to $30,000
to cover the other
correct
spot.
Okay.
I'd recommend a warrant.
Councilor Plosky?
Are there any permits required for, especially where it is potentially going out of state, are there any permits required for the transporting?
It is. They are required, and that's all covered under the final. That's covered under the management fee up top of $10,000. All that covers the fees, the paperwork, and all the regulations that have to be met.
Okay, thank you.
The remedial action plan that they're going to produce, that would be CEI doing that?
Yes.
And that's basically saying we're going to dispose of it this way?
Right, and it's going through the state and getting all the permitting and everything.
All right, and then after we've taken all these piles off-site, what is the next step?
The next
anything
step
else
is to continue operating the shooting range with the non-lead, non-contaminant ammunition. Okay. We've got the...
But there's no... That's good. I agree that makes sense. But there's no additional testing they're going to suggest or anything like
There's some additional testing in this contract here, in this proposal, which is the soil. There's some additional laboratory allowances in there to do some testing.
And of the stockpiles or of the remainder of the site?
The remainder, everything has been stockpiled and all the testing has been done. There could be some potential for some borings after we're done, and that could be covered with a contingency.
Okay. Any other questions? Councilor Hamill?
Right now, we're at this, well, I've got the manual that you put out, that they put out last September.
Right.
And there's pictures in there of piles being covered. Do you know if they put a plastic on the ground prior to putting the pile on there?
I believe so, yes.
Yeah, because it's sitting there for a while. Back when they were using lead bullets, one of the reasons why this was stopped was it wasn't only the Newmarket PD, it was other units that were coming in. Do you know, I know you're not associated with a police department, but do you know if there's anyone else going up there? Or?
Right now, the only people going up there are the Town of Newmarket Police Department. And that's, I believe the council gave a directive several months ago when we looked at this.
That's what I was wondering, yeah.
And they're the only ones that are doing it. And they're only doing their qualifying up there. And they're using the ammunition that has no lead and no lead component at all in it.
Mm-hmm. I don't know. I find it unfortunate that with all the people that were using this in the past, they couldn't pitch in, because that's a... So our next step is to just keep on working the paperwork until we can get out there and do something or get the money to do it. I mean, you're going to continue...
Well, if I'm given the word to move forward, then I will get a firm contract and wait for the warrant article or however we're going to fund this.
Mr. Ranowski, is there any way that we could have discussions with some of the departments or agencies that might have used it for a certain period of time and request them to provide some contributions?
We can do that. We talk to the police department as to which communities used it in addition to the state police, and see if people are willing to contribute towards that. We would still have to write the warrant article with the full amount and then receive the contributions that they may make.
Yeah.
And then it would offset our total cost.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's an unexpected burden that, nobody was purposeful or anything like that. It's just not, we didn't manage it, wasn't managed very long term. But this is an issue, we're not the only town. Exeter obviously has an even more substantial issue.
Really?
With what they were dealing with and the private firearms club that was operating on the town.
There were numerous at one time.
So if we could look into that and make sure we have, whether that's even a possibility by the time we go to town meeting, that would make sense to me. Councilor Jarvis?
So is everyone agreeing that we have to get it out of there?
Yes.
Okay. So the question now that we're just thinking, that we're just talking about is the funding.
Correct.
So where would, I mean, maybe we can also get some things back to us of where we would find, because if we sent this out for a warrant article to approve the funds to do this, if the towns didn't approve the warrant article, we still have to do this, correct?
Correct.
So maybe we should be thinking of some other, I mean, I know the reason why you want to put it to warrant article is because you don't want the money to come out of the water.
No, it's just a suggestion.
No,
I don't think it should come out of the water myself.
Right, and I'm not saying it should come out of the water necessarily, but I'm just concerned if this is going through this, it sounds like we have to do this. We have to remove this out of there. So that's what I'm saying. If everyone here is in agreement that we have to do that, then we need to just start the conversations about the funding.
Right.
And so I think there are more options than just putting it out to a warrant article.
What are those options?
So that's what I'm saying is we should maybe we could talk about those and have some feedback from the finance department of where we might be able to. I mean, maybe it's something that as we start going over the budget, knowing that we're going to have to do these things, possibly putting it into the budget, looking at recouping some of the money, because I believe, and I could be wrong, but I think some of the other police officers paid to use that shooting range. And I could be wrong, but I think that there might have been some payment to use that facility. So if that was the case, I'm not sure where that is, but maybe that could be something towards it. I just think that I'd like to get some, that I'd like to think of, not have a warrant article be the only avenue, but try to think of other ways that we could come up with this, because it's something we have to do.
I don't disagree, but I think it's something that the taxpayers should be paying the burden of versus, and of course, pursuing, if possible, the folks that used it. But the only source that we don't have, if we have $30,000 in the budget on top of all other money we found, then Ed better come in with a negative budget growth.
No, but I'm saying,
I just don't think the money is sitting around available, and there's no grant sources available, I think, for this kind of remediation. And so I think what I'd like to see happen is in January at the business meeting, select the final company, authorize it into a contract contingent upon funding. And I support the warrant article idea. And we can give some time for Ed and Don to look at some other sources. But if there's $30,000 in the budget that's suddenly available, then we've been poor budgeters.
I'm not saying that there's $30,000 possibly available in the budget, but between the CIP and different budget items and going to the police and asking for it, I guess my concern is if it goes out to a warrant article and the warrant article fails, then where are we?
Then we tell the state we have been denied the opportunity to spend the money to do it, and we try again. I mean, that's what I think we'd say. But Commissioner Banowski might have more experience.
Well, I was just going to say the CIP won't be an option for us because, you know, the when individual programs are set up, they're set up for specific programs. So we don't really have, I don't think, a hook that would.
No, you'd have to put something in.
Right,
the CIP.
Have to put it in only to take it out, which would be the same thing as putting a warrant article separate and apart. But I think that. What we do is have the conversation, and I'll have a conversation with the chief to find out who all the other communities were. We'll send him a letter. We'll explain the situation we're up against and ask for, you know, maybe a specific amount of money. If they can contribute $1,000 and we get 10 of them that are doing it, then the town's cost is less than that. Because they, you know, and maybe some of them were heavier users and we ask for a little bit more money. But, you know, I think we need to determine who was it, how much, how often they use it, and what we think is a reasonable contribution from them. It's the best time to do it. They're doing budgets the same like us, so it's a good opportunity. And what we can also do is in the course of putting the option, the warrant article together, if by the time we go to the deliberative session, we know that it's going to be less money, then we would just ask for the town to support that amount of money in order to do the cleanup. So it would help us in all the way around by doing it ahead of time, putting it out to bid.
Okay. Councilor Branch?
Just out of curiosity, have we exhausted all state and federal assistance on this where it is a hazardous site, I guess? Is there any alternatives that we can hit them for?
I don't know. We can investigate that to see if there is something out there. I'm sure that the communities of Exeter and I've had some conversation with the town manager in Franklin, who is also facing the same thing. I think everybody's looking to see if there is some dollars out there, and I'll touch base with them and see if they've explored anything and where we can all go. Maybe together we can do something.
Councilor Plasky.
I also I strongly agree with talking to the other towns that have used this in the past. Right now, there's obvious a need out there for these different towns for firing rangers, and other towns such as Exeter, who is in a tough situation or a similar situation to us as far as the lead goes. Their help in getting this cleaned up would open up the opportunity to give them a place to come and do the firing that they need to do. It's an enticement for them to help us with this project. Follow what I'm saying?
Councilor Jarvis, go ahead.
Right now, Newmarket's the only police that are using that area.
Correct.
So you're suggesting that we maybe say to the people that have used it, agencies that have used it in the past, help us clean it up, and then you can come back and use it?
Exactly.
Councilor Hamill?
It sounds like a good idea, but I'd be careful because of the noise. We had complaints about neighbors over in Durham, actually, that it's right on the line, and I wouldn't want to come up with one hell of a conflict, you know, bang, bang, all day long. I know it's not going to be all day long, but there has been complaints in the past, and I wouldn't want to open some bad wounds with Town of Lee or Durham. So, thank you.
I think the other factor that comes to my mind is we'd have to be very confident that everybody was using the lead-free bullets versus just trusting our own department. So, or I wouldn't want to get in the situation again where 15 years down the road we find out that some of the departments weren't or some of the other agencies using it. So we'll have to think about that more. I know that when we first brought this up, when Chief Collins was here, I think it was during that time when he was leaving, we talked about possibility of an indoor range being built and being available or other options, and that there might have been some private donors who would be willing to help pay for that. I don't think that went anywhere. But that kind of facility there wouldn't impact the water resources. If it doesn't have to be a heated building, it just needs to be constructed to meet the requirements for a firing range. And then you have indoor trap ranges and stuff like that, and it doesn't really matter what bullets you use. I know one of the things they used to do out there was the SWAT training, and they don't really do that inside a building, inside a range. They had prefabricated fake rooms and buildings and long-distance sniper shooting and stuff like that. So I'll schedule this for January workshop to take final action on it, so hopefully you can get some feedback about the alternative sources by then. And by then we'll have the budget, so.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, George. Okay, next item is to consider nominations, appointments, and elections. The first one is the New Market Community Development Corporation, and we have two vacancies that were appointments by the town council, and we have three applicants. We had two in the packet, and we received one that we knew was coming, just didn't come in time for the packet. So the applicants are Nancy Caffin, Clay Sarenbetz, and Cal Witten for terms expiring December 2010. And just a reminder, the process is we open the floor for nominations, and nominations don't have to be seconded, then we vote on each one. And then if there's ties, then we have to cast a vote. You get one vote for each position. So we vote on everybody that gets nominated. And if it's all 5-0 votes, then we each get two votes to split between the three people. That makes sense there. Councillor LaBranche.
I'd like to nominate Cal Witten, I believe it is.
That's correct.
Yes.
All right. Is there any other nominations?
I'd like to nominate Clay Sarenbetz. Excuse the mispronunciation.
Okay.
I'd like to nominate Nancy Rigora Caffin.
All right, everybody that's been applied has been nominated. So, right, and as a member of the NCDC right now and appointed by the council as a public appointment to the NCDC, the NCD did send a letter and requested that Nancy Caffin and Cal Witten be reappointed, and if they were still interested, which they are. And so I would just want to remind the council of that request from the NCDC. And given the point the NCDC is in their process of redeveloping the mills, some continuity within our board and some of the experience is pretty important. Mr. Witten has been a past president of the NCDC and was a banker in his professional life. And Nancy Caffin is an accountant. And so she's currently our treasurer, which is a difficult job for anybody on a volunteer basis. So are there any other nominations? All right, I'm closing the floor for nominations. And so what we'll do is vote on each person one at a time, starting with Nancy, then Clay, and then Cal. So Mr. Wynowski, if we would start with Nancy Caffin. And so go ahead.
Yep,
we're ready.
Councilor Plasky?
Aye.
Councilor Hamel?
That's for
Nancy.
Aye.
Councilor LaBranche?
Aye.
Councilor Jarvis?
Aye.
Chairman Hart?
Aye. All right, Nancy had 5 yes votes. Okay.
Mr. Sarenbitz, Clay Sarenbitz.
Counsel Plasky?
Aye.
Counsel Hamel?
Nay.
Counsel LaBranch?
Aye.
Counsel Jarvis?
Nay.
Counsel Hart?
Nay. All right, so I think that was two votes yes?
That's correct.
Did you vote yes?
I voted yes.
So it's two votes yes, three votes no. All right, the next candidate is Cal Whitten.
Counsel Plasky?
Nay.
Counsel Hamel?
Aye.
Counsel LaBranch?
Aye.
Counsel Jarvis?
Aye.
Chairman Hart?
Aye. Okay, so Mr. Whitten had four, so Nancy and Cal are reappointed. Fortunately, Mr. Sarenbitz has offered himself for another committee, which has two vacancies. That's the Downtown TIF Advisory Board. And the term for that is expiring May 2010. And there's two vacancies, and he's the only candidate that we have, and I don't believe we received any additional ones since
That's correct.
Okay. I'm happy to appoint him to that because he's an active member of the Newmarket Community Development Corporation. Counselor Jarvis?
Did you just nominate
him? No, I didn't because I don't.
I was going to say, I'd like to nominate Clay Sarenbitz for the term expiring 2010 for the TIF.
I'll second that.
Are there any other nominations for the Downtown TIF appointment? And I think this one, you have to be a resident of the TIF, and he is.
That's
he
correct.
Lives in Bryant Rock. Okay, so close the floor to nominations, and please call a roll on Clay Sarenbitz, May 2010, for the Downtown TIF Advisory Board.
Counsel Plasky?
Aye.
Counsel Hamel?
Aye.
Counsel LaBranch?
Aye.
Counsel Jarvis?
Aye.
Chairman Hart?
Aye. All right, so Mr. Sarenbitz has been appointed to the Downtown TIF. All right, the next item is a report from the council. The Council of the Branch Budget Committee.
Okay, Budget Committee. We actually just had a meeting this past Monday, and it was the first televised meeting for the Budget Committee. So it's my understanding that from this point forward, all the public meetings will be televised. We had a presentation from Tom Mahone, I believe. Is that how his name is pronounced?
Yes.
Yes. Mr. Administrator Winowski was there also briefly. Just basically going over some of the budget committee's rules, regulations, duties, which was helpful, especially for me, since it was my first year on the budget committee. We've also had the school budget presented to us. They're currently in at about a 2.93 increase. January 5th, we have, actually January 5th is the council is meeting for the first work session, I believe, on the budget. And the school is also meeting that same day. So it'll be a busy day for the budget committee. And that's all that's going on at this point. Be happy to answer any questions if I can.
Any questions? Mr. Winowski?
I was just gonna say that January 5th is for the presentation of the budget to and work of the council with the department heads on the budget.
Right, that's the workshop, yes.
That's
we usually
Saturday.
Do a Saturday, Wednesday, and Saturday, if I'm not mistaken, right?
Something like that, yeah.
Yeah.
Yep. So that's our next meeting. Well, I guess we have a Wednesday the 2nd or 3rd?
Third.
Any other questions or? Okay. Channel 13 Committee, Councilor Plasky.
Channel 13 Committee has not met. Nothing to report.
Councilor Jarvis, CIP Committee.
The CIP Committee. CIP committee has done a lot of work this year, as I mentioned previously, and we're hoping that we will that our final draft of the CIP will be ready today. I think it might have been edited one more time, but there have been a lot of changes to it. The CIP committee did want me to mention to you that they would really like to be able to talk about the CIP that's presented to the town council prior to when we meet on it for the budget. So besides them coming in during our when we're going over it through the budget, they've requested that there be a separate meeting to discuss the CIP. So they wanted me to bring that to your attention and ask that the town council carve out some time to discuss the CIP other than within the budget process. They just feel like there's been a lot of changes to it, a lot of work done to it, and they'd really like to see some attention to it. So I said I would bring that up and ask the council what their wishes are on that.
Okay. Thank you, Councillor Wolford Hamel. Well, any questions? For the Conservation Commission, Councillor?
No, I canceled the meeting due to members' safety that night on the driving home in a storm.
Downtown TIF, Councillor Jarvis.
The meetings keep getting canceled.
All right, no meeting. Fire Department Study Committee, Councillor LaBranche.
Okay, we did have our last meeting postponed. It was on December 13th, and it was due to weather. But we're making progress as far as presenting one solution to the council. And I guess the question is, when would be a good time for us to present that to the council? I don't believe it really involves anything as far as having to be budgeted for at this point.
If it's going to have a budgetary impact, then January. If not, it can be February or March. So, but if you're asking you want to do it sooner, then we can put it onto a workshop. But if it, do you see what I mean?
Workshop in January?
Yeah, right now there's nothing on my list for January workshop, but I'm sure there are things that will be on that.
So. Right. If we could, I think we can probably have something together to give everyone a feel for what we're trying to accomplish, at least at this point in time.
That's good. Thank you. Highway Public Safety, Councillor Hamel.
Nothing to report. We've had no meetings. However, I did check with the we've had quite a few complaints with the flashing light, school flashing light. So I checked with the PD and the school department, and they're both of them are somewhat hounding Division 6, and they just can't seem to get the best of it. But there's still there's two groups here checking on it.
There was a suggestion at a previous meeting, and I just wanted to reemphasize it with the sidewalk on B Street extension being put in, that the configuration with Elm Street intersection probably needs to be looked at because when cars park down that way, when cars park across from L&M parallel to the street now, and cars park next to L&M, it's really kind of messy. So there might need to be some discussion about limiting parking at certain points.
Mm-hmm. That and also the committee needs to address the fact that we have now parking spaces on Exeter Street where we didn't in the past, and we need to designate them. So I've asked the Highway Safety Committee to deal with both that issue on B Street and down on Exeter Road.
Councilor,
you did.
Yeah, I spoke with Chief Sear because he's part of that, and it could just be we have to get it addressed at some point.
So you have a meeting coming up. Councillor Ranch?
Just to add about the light for the school, I believe the one on this end of town isn't even functioning at this point.
That's correct.
So that's become a definite safety problem. The other end off from Grant Road, that one blinks. Reason I know is because I go by it every morning, and it's like, Jesus, it's not on. But then you go to the other end of town, and, oh, it's on. So either the bulb's burnt out or something's wrong with it. So somebody should be addressing that.
Thank you. Main Street Committee, Councilor Glennon is not present. NCDC, the NCDC is in the process of applying for a variance from the Zoning Board of Adjustment and met with the Planning Board and gave an initial introduction to the proposal. And so the ZBA meeting is in January, the first Monday after New Year's, January 7th, I think, or 8th. And it's a variance request for use and number of units, I think. But I'm not going to get into the technical details because that's what the process is for, and I don't know them sufficiently to be able to answer any questions. But it's but we're happy that we're moving forward with that step and appreciate the support of the council in terms of helping address the parking needs for that redevelopment. Planning Board update, Councillor LaBranche.
Okay, you took my thunder on the mills.
Oh, sorry. Hey, no, it's my first real report.
Basically, if you don't mind, I mean, a couple of points that were brought up during the Planning Board meeting in regards to that. They're looking at potentially up to 151 rental units, 1 and 2 bedroom units in that the mill buildings. Potentially at the onset, there'll be, you know, 5-year minimum lease on them. And then what happens after the 5 years, turn into condos, whatever, remain as rental, whatever happens. But there's also a 10 to 15% artist living work area that's going to be incorporated into that. And I believe there's 25,000 square feet that's going to be set aside for civic and cultural facilities owned or retained by the NCDC.
I think it's 2,500. Correct.
What did I say?
25,000.
I'm sorry. That's right. I had 2,500 written down. I said it wrong. So, but that's a little update there. And, you know, they seem to be progressing very well at this point. So.
And there's also, I think it's 10, it might be 15,000 square feet of commercial.
Yes. Yeah, there wasn't anything that was definitely mentioned. There was Arlen did mention the commercial aspect of it, but it didn't go into too much detail on it. Another topic on the agenda that evening was the old Selectwood building, which is now referred to as Lamprey Falls LLC. They have received conditional approval for 15 units, but there are 17 conditions on the approval, so there's still, you know, a substantial amount of work to go forward with that. On a sad note, unfortunately, the application for 3 North Main Street, which is down by Houghton's Hardware, was denied a continuance by the Planning Board. And just to say a little bit about the Dunkin' Donuts on Exeter Street, we had a site walk this past Saturday. And discussed some of the concerns and issues with the entrance for the drive-through and locations of driveways and parking areas and stuff. So we're moving along with that. But doing some good things on the planning board, hopefully. Any questions?
All right. Okay, Councilor Gunn's not present for Riverwalk. School Board, Councilor Plasky?
Nothing to report. Okay.
Old business and new business. Councilor Jarvis.
I was wondering if we had put the ad out about the old Public Works building. Okay. And just wondering, I had heard that the Baseball Association might be interested in looking at it for possible baseball batting cages and things like that. Did anybody get in contact with you?
I haven't.
About that? Okay. About I suggested that they come to you, but the... there was one of the coaches from the from the youth baseball suggested that maybe we could do some batting cages in there and stuff and have some other towns come in and rent it out and use it. So I suggested that they talk to you about that. Is there a way, I know this is kind of revisiting two things we've already talked about, but going back to the cleanup of the fire range, is there a way for us to get the information about the from the other police departments and enough time for us to be able to discuss this during the budget process? Because I really think I'd like to try to put it in the budget for next year. So whether, like I said before, whether we try to get it in the CIP or whether we try to get it into our budget for next year, I'd like to see that. So hopefully that, I don't think that idea was thrown out the door, that it was definitely a Warren article. And the other thing was, what would you like me to tell the CIP committee? I kind of mentioned that they were requesting that they have some time to meet with the council. What I told them was that most likely, you know, that we would be discussing the CIP during the budget session, and we would certainly allot a long period of time for us to have that discussion, whether it be on the Saturday or the Wednesday, but that was most likely the scenario that was going
to
happen. So.
That makes sense to me to do it that way, and I assume we would get the written CIP in advance.
That's the hope, was that you would have the written CIP probably the beginning of next week,
okay,
and that everyone will have read it, and if there are any questions, they can contact CIP members before that date, but that we schedule them for a good chunk of time.
Yeah.
Is that in agreement with everybody?
Yeah.
Makes sense to me.
All right. Thank you.
I'd like not to do it as another night meeting.
Well, that's what I told them, that it probably wouldn't be, but I
fit it within that, and we oftentimes scheduled 8 to 4 and would be done by 1.
Right.
So if we have to be there till 2 or 2:30, that's okay. So make sure we have a good lunch.
Okay.
Thanks, and I'm glad they worked so hard on it to try to pull together a more comprehensive document that's a little easier to follow, which is, I understand, what a lot of the work's been. So
that's it. Thank you.
Anything else? Councilor Ranch?
Just briefly, and wondering where we are with the Black Bear TIF area. if we're going to be bringing that up in the near future, or?
I intend to, yes. I've just been trying to clear about other things, and that is one of the projects that I put on my desk to get some resolution to. I unfortunately was supposed to have met with the Newfields of Selectmen to talk about the bridge on New Road, and not realizing that they meet in a secret location by the police department, I missed the meeting. I've called a gentleman, one of the selectmen, to set up an alternate date to go and talk with them. If that is a possibility that we can obtain the opportunity to rehab the bridge, and it makes our entrance opportunity shine a lot brighter, and we'd be able to move forward with that. But to go through all the different things, while I've been doing some other research, I've been finding bits and pieces of information that have sort of been filling in spots for me, putting that together. So I'm hoping by sometime in January to get that report off my desk and into your hands so you can all talk about it.
Okay. And can you just update us on where we are with in regards to the audit? I know we've got the computer system that you're attempting to sort and itemize different things. Is there an update on that? Are we getting any closer to?
Yes. In fact, Herb Myers from Laserfish sent an email to me on Monday indicating that they're ready to come in through a portal to access all of the information that's been scanned into the Laserfish and activate it such that we can retrieve it and see what it is as we want. I've asked Don and Doug to work with those folks in order to do that, and so that's already in the process. The other piece that I had briefly spoken about relative to having the council members have access to the system such that from your home you can go in and look at all of the bills, the payables and payroll records or whatever it is you want. They recently sent me a new proposal. It's down $5,000, but I just put in a call to one of the vendors at Laserfish just to get some clarification, because I'm trying to work it down a little bit further, and that might be an option to, if I can get them down another about $2,000, it'll be about $10,000 to $8,000 of which just to purchase the software, and then probably two or three at the most user licenses so that members of the council could go in at any time. Okay. And look at it. So that's still in the process. We're working towards that.
Great. Thank you.
Councilor Jarvis.
Just to follow up on that, are they going to be overseeing the information that's put online? Because I'm just concerned that if we're showing, like, checks that are written to pay for somebody's medical bill, that the medical bill doesn't show up there with somebody's diagnosis on it, or that when we're showing payroll records, we're not sharing people's Social Security numbers and all of that stuff. So they're going to go through all of that and make sure that confidential information doesn't get
out. Well, we, meaning the finance office, would have the ability to put the information that the council members would be looking at. So, you know, we have the interesting part about the laser fee system is we have the ability to redact information from our end. So that way, if you were to call it up, you would see a black box.
Great.
But you'd see the bill, and you'd see what the cost is, and you'd see how it was paid and what it was for and everything. So it gives us a lot of technological opportunities to do certain things. And, you know, as I said, we could determine how much information we're going to put. So if we have tons of little pieces of paper attached to it, we could do a summary. And that's one of the things that we've talked to the department heads about, is creating summaries of information and signing off. You'd still attach that, but we don't have to scan all that stuff in, make it much easier for you to go through that material.
Okay. I have one more.
Sure.
Can I request that we have on a future agenda that we actually discuss the Arbor Park and who's going to be the committee on that, and invite the Riverwalk to make a presentation on their desire to take stewardship of it, if that's what their wish is.
Okay.
Thank you.
Anything else? Okay. Thank you all for a good meeting. At this point, I guess we're adjourned.
Motion to adjourn.
Okay. Councilor Branch. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Anybody opposed?